Right? Good morning! That's much better. Okay. So, I'm glad to be here. I'm impressed. In Seattle, we have so many fantastic people who are so interested in AI. That's absolutely right. Hey, also, so many old face friends in the audience. So for my presentation, I just want to really be short, precise, and entertaining, if possible. So I want to, you know, mostly focus on a few demos. Most likely that could actually be wrong. But you know, that is the limitation of the technology. So Microsoft, like many other great companies in this area, like Amazon, Starbucks, taking AI very seriously. When Microsoft established the research lab in 92, probably 91, my math is always bad. Okay. The vision for Microsoft Research Lab was very clear: make computers to see, listen, and speak. That vision, through many fantastic AI researchers and engineers, we have realized that vision. So when I was running speech group about 10 years ago, the mission for the group was very simple: making speech mainstream. Today, just a month ago, The Economist had a cover story: speech is mainstream. So through 20 or 25 years persistent research and engineering, all of us made this a reality. So congratulations to all of you. At least you're interested in AI, that's why you are here today, right? So Microsoft formed a new group. I just had a new job. I'm the technical fellow leading the newly formed speech and language group. This is a group that will provide the core speech and language research and development to enable Cortana, Skype, and beyond. So this is a new group. I feel just, you know, after 10 years running speech, I'm back to take care of the old job and the old friends. Hope I can recruit some of my old friends come back to work in Microsoft. So I think the best way to actually run this whole thing is let's actually see the real capability of AI. AI is actually fairly simple. Don't actually be misled. Without the data, AI is nothing. So now we are in this era of AI, mostly because the beauty of data, the availability of data and the computing that enabled, you know, our AI researchers really to create a breakthrough. So Microsoft's mission is really to democratize AI. So you can benefit from using the advanced technology we have refined and polished over the last 30 years. Of course, through that process, hopefully we can monetize AI together. Just by democratizing AI without monetizing it, it's probably not helpful to anyone, right? So those two are really the key pillars I want to emphasize. If you can look at the Microsoft AI portfolio, we have the broad spectrum of everything from agent, applications, services, and the infrastructure. On the research front, we had a major breakthrough on the image genetic recognition that actually reached the human parity. The approach we used was really a very deep neural net. It's so deep, I couldn't even put all of them on this slide deck. Like image recognition, the speech group also reached the human parity on the most famous switchboard task. This task was basically funded by the US government more than 20 years ago. And many people in this audience worked on that project, from Nico to Li Den, Chao Wu. I just actually see so many faces, you know, for people working on speech. When Microsoft established its speech group in 93, the error rate on that task was around 80%. Because that was basically two people talking like me, you know, naturally, conversationally over the phone, and the US government wanted to transcribe the conversation. So they could actually anticipate whether there's ISIS or not. That was 25 years ago. US government really had the vision. Today, this was the cover story from The Economist. You know, over the last 40 years, it's just amazing. Microsoft, together with many colleagues in the industry and the research, reached the human parity on that switchboard task. So I want to actually give you the demo, because I'm not rich enough, I cannot hire a closed captionist to be here to do the sign language or transcribe everything. But with this Azure GPU resources, with Microsoft cognitive services, such as customer speech service, the underlying technology can be democratized. So I can afford today to bring a closed captionist with me. Let's see how that goes.
Oh, I have to catch my flight very soon. So, this now might have error, but that's why I want to make this whole conversation entertaining.
So, unlike Amazon Echo, I do not have fancy microphone. So I have to wear this microphone and tether myself to the device.
But you can see I have the live streaming, everything I'm talking.
I was born in China, educated in Scotland. So my English is like Chinese Scottish English. Why are you laughing? So I was doing the same demo at the Microsoft Executive Retreat. I said the same thing. I said the Chinese, Scottish, English. And everyone laughed. You know, there were about 200 CVPs and technical fellows. Laughed, you know, so loud. I was so puzzled. I said, what the heck did I say? Chinese, Scottish, English. Oh, I realized on the screen that was transcribed as Chinese garbage English. So, my Chinese, Scottish, English. Now you can see the Microsoft AI performance. This is being transcribed to the cloud, running on Azure, through customer speech service. Close captioning agent to do something for every part of your TV. But the best is not just to transcribe everything. In this audience, I did a rough estimate. Probably there are 20 languages spoken beyond English at home. Right? Lots of Chinese, maybe Cantonese, Hunanese, Shanghainese, whatever. People from India, from Pakistan, from Germany, France, Spain. What if you can have everything just transcribed and translated? The problem is that this thing is not big enough. I don't put English on the top. If I want to put the 20 languages, you're not going to see the content. Right? Let's do another demo. See how we can break the language barrier. So, instead of transcribing everything only into English, or Arabic, whatever you want. I can speak Arabic from time to time. And let's actually do another demo. How many have you installed Microsoft Translator? What? Hugh Redmond is a small company called Microsoft. It's doing an amazing amount of work on AI, on speech, language, computer vision. And we have product form, like this one was basically a customer speech service as part of cognitive services on Azure. Nobody knows. You guys first saw this demo, right? Live transcription, not as good as human parity, because I'm Scottish, English, right? But for native American speaker, this is actually pretty damn good, I can tell you. On the switchboard, when you have 10x computing resources,
Microsoft speech will do a better job than any of you in this room. That was the breakthrough. But of course, we want to offer a production system, even with my Chinese, Scottish, English. What was the performance? What's your estimate on the error rate? 5%? I just basically talked casually, randomly, you know, joked, cracked jokes. Roughly 10% to 5%, because I had the confidence. Sometimes I said Scottish English became garbage English, but it's okay. That's just, you know, 5% of the time, it could be wrong, right? So let me do another demo. Since you have not, is what the heck is going on? So many emails, so many stuff. Go to Microsoft Translator. Join the conversation. Scan the barcode. Now let me talk in Chinese. So on my mobile devices, I install Microsoft Translator. I join the conversation. You can install Microsoft Translator right now. You can speak in German, French, Spanish, Finnish, whatever. There are 16 languages we're supporting. Let's see if you can break the language barrier. And use Microsoft.
我非常高兴今天在这里能和大家一起聊一聊天。 Did you see the English got translated instantaneously? I don't know why I didn't turn on the TTS. Actually, TTS was turned on, but the audio didn't actually speak out from my PC. And let me unplug this audio so you can hear from my PC.
Anyway, whatever. You know, TTS is not that hard anyway, so. So if you guys want to join the conversation, scan the code, join the conversation, you can test. Everything will be spoken on stage. Language barrier is gone. Your English is not great, fantastic. Have the closed caption in your own language. Install Microsoft Translator today. That's a pop, you know, powered by deep neural nets, as Professor Li Deng was here. Yeah, Professor Li Deng talked about, you know, Microsoft speech recognition, image recognition, translation, language understanding, they're all enabled by deep learning. And this is just a small number of services we're offering that you can use today. Let me get back to the slides. So you guys can say whatever you want from your mobile devices to randomize my talk, that's okay. Let's see, I really need to finish this here so I can go to the airport. So translation started from IBM Watson, as you can see, in 1954, before I was born. And through generations of dedicated people, Microsoft and others are able to bring this to the hands of everyone, for people like you and me. If you are a developer with Microsoft Cognitive Services, you're able to really create fantastic AI applications. Absolutely using the state-of-the-art AI we created over the last 30 years. With speech recognition, synthesis, image recognition, language understanding across the board. We have 25 API services that Microsoft polished over the last 30 years. And you can just, you know, through the REST API, no matter if you're using iOS, Android, or whatever device you want to have, you can have this Azure-enabled intelligence for your application.
So let me talk about a little bit of details, how we achieve that major breakthrough. So on the switchboard, as I said, you know, when Microsoft first established our own speech group, the error rate was around probably 70 to 80% in 93. Today, this is the hard core. You can see core home task and the switchboard task. And we use really six different neural networks. They are working in parallel. In the cloud, it's okay. You know, I talk, Azure has enough VMs, right? You perform six speech recognition in parallel. Then you put them together through for different language models. Essentially, there are 10 neural nets working in parallel to actually create that engineering breakthrough. That's absolutely an engineering wonder. And that's how we achieve this breakthrough. So the demo I gave you was using the cheapest, worst neural nets, but it was so fast. So fast, we can actually see the demo. Actually, I need to show you one more demo. That's gonna make you laugh again. I will get back to my microphone. Okay, let me get my microphone. You guys like demo, right?
Yeah.
So I just want to make sure I'm entertaining you, not just, you know, make you fall into sleep. Okay, I need to, is it working now? It's a part of Windows. By the way, if you use Mac, sorry, only Windows supports this. So, for the curse word, this is fucking good. Did you notice? Did you notice this is fucking good? It's a fucking fast. But they ignored all those bad words, educated me to speak a better Scottish English. So I really don't want to curse. I'm sorry.
That's a demo. I can really see, I can say F so loudly.
I love this demo. I could actually really vent my interesting F words to the public. But the Microsoft Customer Speech Service is very, very good gentleman. So ignore everything I said badly and behaved reasonably okay. So, this, you know, I forgot that demo. That's why I wanted to show you. AI is really just amazing. So this is really underlying technology. We use a combination of different neural nets. Basically, it's a combination of recurrent neural nets, convolutional neural nets, different variants, and that actually achieved the magic breakthrough. So this is kind of errors between humans and Microsoft speech. And I cast in New Orleans just 2 weeks ago. We put a, you know, computer speech recognition result side by side with human transcription. Even for the professional speech people. And I cast, there were about like a few thousand of them. They cannot tell the difference. So the human parity is not just we claim we achieve. We put this through the test in the Microsoft booth, let the people to tell, is this compute output or human transcription? There was no difference. That's not what we want to do. And we're not complacent. Our goal is absolutely perform better than any of you and a professional transcriber. So 5.8 is not our goal. Our goal is absolutely provide much better speech system that will actually make your life much easier. Just like a car runs faster than any of us. Computer will understand the human language much better than any of us. But today, we have the ability only to transcribe. Understanding is much harder. So I wanted to really emphasize
is not a solved problem. So I talk about translate, break the language barrier. Translation is also just amazing, and I expect within 2 years, translation quality will be reaching human level, just like speech recognition. This is also part of the charter in my group in speech and language in the uniform one. So if you guys really want to work on absolute state of art on the D, I really don't think there's a better team like speech and language. So as I said, you know, chat is hard. Professor Li Deng also said that, very good, gave a fantastic talk about the, you know, three generations of conversational system. Unfortunately, maybe Professor Li Deng will not agree with me. There's no established recipe. Most of those systems are working on the toy problem. Unlike speech recognition today, there's a recipe. You follow the recipe, you can get a decent speech recognition performance. For the chatbot conversational system, there's still many, many hundred flowers. Whether they're going to be real flower or just, you know, grass is yet to be seen. So instead of just worry about the three generations of conversational system, there's still lots of work that need to be done. So I want to actually talk about a few things from engineering point of view, what Microsoft did to drive the breakthrough in this area. So the first one is really, wow, the color got messed up. How many of you have heard about Xiaobing? Xiaobing? Okay. So this is really just an amazing chatbot that engages with you emotionally. And if you have nothing to do, you can chat with Xiaobing and entertain yourself. 自娱自乐,非常棒. So we did the same thing for Japan. Have you heard about this? I want to do a quiz. What's the name of this Japanese chatbot?
Rina.
Awesome. Do you know 25% of the Japanese web population are chatting with this agent? Not 25% of computer users. 25% of the Japanese population. Love it. They're so courteous. It is amazing to see how Japanese behave when they talk to the bot. Very different from American, very different from Chinese. It's just amazing. Of course, we had the Tay, that was a, you know, interesting moment, and then we launched the Zoe. Somehow the color got just messed up. The title you cannot see, but you can guess. You know, there's a Xiaobing, there's a Japanese Rina, there's the American version. So you can, if you have nothing to do, you want to be entertained, chat with those emotional agents. Hey, sometimes you want to find a friend, right? Really, those are your best friends. No matter if you are speaking Chinese, Japanese, or English. Of course, oh, now I find a good color on the title. Yeah, Xiao Eyes, Xiao Bing, Rina, that's Japanese. And the Zhou is the US English equivalent. But I don't want to just stop there. That, for entertaining, is fantastic. But Microsoft has a very serious customer support bot dealing with Microsoft support. This is in production. How many of you have ever used this one? Before you talk to the real agent, you can chat with Microsoft support, really resolve your case efficiently, like a technical support. This is already in production on support.microsoft.com. Let me do a demo. This is based on the fourth generation of what Professor Li Deng talked about. But we never published anything. Sorry, but we have a production system. I just want to make a joke here. Maybe fifth generation, if you think fourth is not powerful enough. Or sixth. Okay, go to support. So people can come to the support, find out you know, Windows problem, Skype problem. So you can contact us. In the past, when you contact us, you just basically reach out, talking to live agent. Now with contact us, you know, function, you're talking to Microsoft AI. So what is the problem you have on Microsoft product? Anyone could come up with something. Let me just do a demo. I forgot my password. That's usually, oh, I had a typo. So it's like, you know, chatting like with a live agent. Let me start over. How to upgrade to Windows 10. I don't know what is going on. We have a few bucks working on the chat. But it's real. Okay, you see the challenge of natural language? I just, you know, paraphrase that differently. Now it's asking, what is my old version of Windows? I say Windows 7. You got an answer? If you, you know, you're not happy, you can talk to a person, a live agent will really continue the conversation. It's pretty effective. But you see, it's real, you know. Sometimes it doesn't work well. That's why we need a seventh generation from Professor Li Deng to help us to solve. This is the sixth generation. So Microsoft technical support is fairly broad, really broad. I want just, you know, invite anyone to come up with a question you might have, so you can. I want to see the live demo. Do you guys have any question about the Microsoft product? Pretended one. What? Okay, let's see. Start over. Did that solve your problem? Okay, what is the other one? See, you have many options. Restart your PC, wipe it off, blah, 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 right? I think this is pretty helpful. I will actually give it a vote. And any, another one?
Does it actually check?
Huh?
Has your touch screen on
that? I cannot hear you.
I mean, the agent really knows whether the system has a touch screen on that? No, right?
You ask, because the customer said my touch screen doesn't work, right? I can't hear you, I'm sorry, too far away. But do you have another question here? Let's just do it. I said, my talk is trying to make you guys, you know, feeling not bored. Otherwise, you're sitting here for 1 hour, not worth it, right? Being happy. That's actually create a hard problem for Microsoft support. Great, you guys really have no issue with Microsoft product. It all works well.
That's hard one.
Dr. Tan.
To cap screen.
Ben? Is that your problem? I think this one is it. That's the answer. Okay? Dr. Tan, your problem is too easy. I want to challenge to have a hard problem. Okay?
How do I find my MAC address?
How do you find what?
My MAC address.
MAC address. MAC address. That's really an IT hot one. Let's see. How do you spell MAC? MAC? That's I. Let's see if that has the answer. The internet is not working with your Mac. But fine. We solved that problem too. Well, now I like this now. It's more entertaining. Well, you're participating. Fantastic.
My Windows 7 updates are broken.
Windows 7 update, we don't longer support Windows 7 anymore.
Question.
Let's see, okay. Now we're doing the troubleshooting on your Windows 7 update. Is that right? No? Okay, we have more work to do. Eighth generation chatbot. Professor Li Dan, now we skipped from third generation to eighth now. Yeah. Okay, yes, one more, last one.
How do I enable autosave in Mac Office?
So, can you repeat the question?
How do I enable autosave in Macintosh version of Office?
Huh? I'm able. Save. Right?
Yes.
Ah, that's, I think this is going to break. The second one. Yeah. No? So, Microsoft support is not really trying to replace people. We always have live agent standing behind. We're trying to actually offer the first line for the most frequent typical problem. That's actually a great example of AI and the humans working together to improve the efficiency of any organization. Okay, I think that's enough. You guys got entertained. Let me just close this one. My time is running out. Let me just skip a few slides. I'll skip a few. It's okay. Now I want to just say a few words about behind the scene. How we did what we demonstrated, from human parity, speech recognition, image recognition, chatbot is not really the eighth generation, it's the third generation, as Professor Li Dan talked about, but it's in production. And that was based on Microsoft Deep Learning Toolkit. It's called the Cognitive Toolkit, formerly known as CNTK. So that's the secret sauce. It's open source. But CNTK is not the only thing. You actually have a range of services available. From bot framework, you can create a bot, to cognitive services that package roughly 25 APIs, from speech to language to speller to emotion. Actually, you can upload your image. We know if you're happy, jealous, or angry. And you must have heard about this, how old on that, right? That was also based on Microsoft Cognitive Services. You up your image, will guess your real age. So there's just lots of interesting services you can build using Microsoft Cognitive Services. Many of them, like speech, Emotion API, they were all created using CNTK. So I want to say a few words about the infrastructure support. The first one is the bot framework. With bot framework, you can really just create a bot, then get that published through all the different channels, whether it's a Skype, or Facebook, or a web. So this is free. You can just, you know, go and install on your device to create the bots you want. The underlying technology supporting bot framework is essentially LUIS, Language Understanding Services. This was a fantastic team in my lab, far away from here. So any of you cannot recruit them because they're in Cairo, Egypt. Unless you want to establish a lab in Egypt, in Africa. So this is a fantastic team. They created Language Understanding Intelligent Services, and now it's being combined into the bot framework to make bot framework even more powerful. And as I said, there are really over 20 APIs. And the speech recognition demo I just did was based on customer speech service. This was another lab in my team, far away from here. But that's actually in Munich, in Germany. It's a fantastic team. Through German engineering, we created such a fantastic breakthrough on speech recognition. So those are some of the examples what we did to enable the service. So Louis, Chris, and you can go actually sign up to do that work today. So it's Chris.ai. Go to Chris.ai. You can customize speech recognition to your domain. If it's not Scottish English, no problem. It's Chinese English or Cantonese English. It's all okay. Really give you the horsepower to create Cortana for your own needs or Alexa for your own needs. It's really just, you know, you have the ability to customize speech recognition as if you own and control all the resources like Microsoft speech and the languages team. That's how we are trying to democratize AI. Through custom speech services, you can create your own domain, language model, speech recognition model, accent, whatever you want, because the tool is available. It runs on Azure. For language understanding, it's the same thing for Louis.ai. So that's a glimpse of the AI portfolio. But behind the scene, the real tool that is close to the metal is Microsoft Cognitive Toolkit, or what we call CNTK. It's really a Cinderella, because everyone is talking about TensorFlow this, TensorFlow that. Google got all the attention, right? But in Seattle, there are two great companies, Microsoft and Amazon. Microsoft got a CNTK, Amazon got a MXNet. Both are actually more efficient than TensorFlow. But the problem is that most people don't know, right? If you look at the GitHub store, actually I want to do a live show. So you can see the dirty laundry of this reality. If you can go to the website, look at the GitHub store, store history, let's see. So that's the kind of popularity of the deep learning framework that will come up. The one that is so dominant is called the TensorFlow. Everyone else combined is not even a match of TensorFlow. So congratulations to my Google friends. Jeff Dean and his team did a fantastic job. But the reality I want to tell you is, in Seattle, there are actually two great companies, Amazon and Microsoft. And where's Microsoft? Microsoft is the green one, number three. Amazon is the orange one, number four. Number three is from Berkeley Cafe. So you can see the velocity of TensorFlow is just amazing, right? Even with that base, they're still growing much faster than than anyone else. We're kind of flat. We have about 10,000 stars. MXNet is also doing well, trying to catch up with CNTK. Not bad. Baidu is the blue one. The, you know, the same big company has their own toolkit, but the real story is, in my view, CNTK is the most efficient. And you can benchmark. I didn't say that. Let's actually see what others said. And I want to come back to the PowerPoint. This is the benchmark from NVIDIA. Of course, they didn't include MXNet. MXNet probably is actually similar to CNTK. I want to say something good about them, you know, our friends in Seattle, because we're going to see so many friends. I have a lot of them across the lake. And it's as good as CNTK at this point, I would say. But this is the benchmark, not for me, not from Amazon, from NVIDIA. 5 minutes, I will finish in 5 minutes, no worry. I control time, I can accelerate. If you need me to finish now, I'm happy to finish now. So, efficiency, you see that, right? This is the real data on the autonomous driving data that enabled your Tesla, autonomous driving. Actually, Tesla is based on NVIDIA platform. The computer world has a benchmark. They said the performance, you can performance CNTK is 10, MXNet is 10. I just don't know why they gave TensorFlow 10 as well. But then they're good. Really, you know, it's, this is from the third party review. So I'll close here. This all runs on Azure. This is the portfolio of Microsoft. And we are really here in a very exciting era, using AI to enable all the services, all the products, and both first party and the third party. I want to get that message across, and this is the most exciting time. We're going to see a huge breakthrough to enable people and organization to be more efficient and more productive. Instead of a focus on using AI to beat humans, like some of the company, I beat you on the chess, I beat you on the Go game. Microsoft is focused on using AI to help you, an organization, to be more productive. That's my talk. Thank you. Where's the chairman? Bill. Do we have time for questions? Or you're all hungry? I'm hungry now. Yeah. That's a good question. The, you know, we actually support the other toolkits. Let's take the CNTK 2.0 as example. We have a CAFE 2 converter. So you can basically take the CAFE model, because it's not as fast as CNTK. The converting into CNTK continue to run. If you want to have everything outputted as CAFE, you can convert into CAFE model. So we are open source on GitHub. You have all the source code. You can make whatever changes you want. And we're trying to support other competing system as much as we can. And TensorFlow has good tooling, like a TensorBoard. And TensorBoard can actually also visualize CNTK model. So it's not like you are on CNTK, you are screwed. You can actually take the best from TensorFlow, the best from CAFE, and make sense out of it. But the CNTK really the most powerful benchmark. This was coming from Hong Kong Baptist University, because it came from the speech research group from my team. So it has been tested using CNTK for speech. Also, the human parity was, you know, powered by CNTK. Cortana speech was powered by CNTK. Emotion API was powered by CNTK. So within Microsoft, you know, most of the workloads are using CNTK. I didn't force them. They just because they use it, because it's fast. So, but outside of Microsoft, the story is unclear. I just want to say, we are supporting other toolkits. If you want to actually bridge the gap, contribute back to CNTK, you're welcome. Okay? Thank you. The question is whether CNTK is used to support mobile devices. Right now, CNTK is mostly cloud-based solution. It's the unique advantage is really distributed system, on lots of GPUs across the machines. If you focus on running on the device, we do not have good story yet, but that is something we're considering.
Right
here. Yeah. Thanks. So when you talk about performance, you're talking about the CNTK. In my opinion, MXNet and CNTK are the two leading ones in terms of performance. Not because Amazon is close. It's just the fact. But on the recurrent neural nets, CNTK is superior. Based on Hong Kong Baptist University benchmark, we are 5 times faster than the next best on the recurrent neural nets. So that is the particularly strong area of CNTK. You will hear from Frank this afternoon about the CNTK details. Go to his session, download the CNTK, like us on the GitHub. At least we've got more stars. Just right now, most of you are just liking TensorFlow. You're liking it because I don't know. Whether you know why you're liking it.
Yeah. Hi, my name is Garnett, and thanks for a great, funny, and interesting share. Here's my question. A year ago, there is a AI software called Tai published on Twitter in educating the audience, and it was voted by all the dirty words, and you guys have to put it out, if you can remember.
I don't remember any dirty words, because as you can see from the demo, any dirty words I did speak got filtered out immediately.
Okay, so what's the improvement after a year?
Improvement of that dirty word?
T-A-Y. The one was on Twitter, and...
we have Zoe.
Yep.
Zoe is the new one.
Okay.
Yeah.
And how is
Tay is gone.
Oh yeah, and how is that different between, will you guys wait on Twitter again, and how is that different between these two versions?
Zoe is the one we are embracing, we are supporting. Which one? Tay is gone, right? I didn't say that. So Tay basically, machine learning, as I said, AI is learning from data. Because what's learning from, what happened. There are enough dirty words on the internet. So we didn't do a super, super good job to filter them out. But Zoe, we did a much better job.
Thanks so much.
Thank you. If no more questions, I think I, okay.
I am appreciate your enthusiastic about CNTK
and Microsoft technologies. One question to you is, there's no that many mobile devices using Microsoft OSs. So how are you going to solve the usage problem like translator, all those apps? It's so great. I am still using them, but not that much in Android, even iPhone world.
That's a good question. Windows Phone, how many people are using Windows Phone in this room? Still, we have a few, right? So my point is that yes, Windows Phone is not the dominant one. That's the reality. But Microsoft takes mobile more broadly than just a physical device. So when you think about the mobile, ambient computing, cloud first, look at the solution, right? Microsoft Translator, Office, Skype, they are running on all those devices. What we want is in the multi-device environment, your experience engaging with your productivity solution is across the hardware itself. So that is the view we are taking. And also, this is still evolving, the device. Look at that, Amazon Echo. It's not mobile devices, but it's very popular. People love that device. So I believe there's still lots of room for us to innovate, because the core technology is there. We just need to really connect the dots. Really, you know, for all of you, it's not the end of innovation. AI is going to be the game changer. This phone is good, internet is good, PC was good, mainframe was good, but the best is yet to come. That impact will be bigger than industrial revolution. That is why you guys are all in the right time. I just, you know, I feel bad. I did my AI research more than 20 years ago. And at that time, speech recognition was hard, was tough. There was no deep learning. But the speech was really one of the pioneers using statistic, you know, deep learning, big data, map reduce. Because I can tell you, when I was in the Carnegie Mellon, before I came to Microsoft, we used the map reduce to train the system on the Sun workstation. This was like, you know, in 1990. So massive scale training. But at that time, there was no GPU. You know, everything was slow, but the map reduce was already implemented in the speech training pipeline and the Carnegie Mellon. This was, you know, in the 80s, 89 to 90. So speech guys are really, really serious. They're very pragmatic. So if you want to really have huge impact, consider Microsoft Speech and Language Group. I cannot resist because we're hiring like crazy. This is my second week in the job. Okay, I have a new job. So if you like what we do, please support us. Contact me about working in my division. Thank you.